Hey everybody, Austin back again with another Let's Play video. Today it's going to be Thunder Force 4 for the Sega Genesis, otherwise known as Lightning Force for the North American Sega Genesis. We're playing the Japanese version basically, which is known as Thunder Force 4, and in North America it is Lightning Force. Not lightning, like L-I-G-H-T. N-I-N-G, it is L-I-G-H-T-E-N, I don't know if it actually stands for lightning, like lightning bolts, or if it's like to lightening force, ooh. So, this is the fourth version, or the fourth entry in the long-running Thunder Force series, and probably my personal favorite in the whole series. I think it's the most mature version of, the 16-bit Thunder Force games of parts 2, 3, and 4. And it's not too difficult. It's got some really nice graphics. It's got a kick-ass soundtrack. It's just a great game overall. And it's one I highly recommend trying out if you haven't played it before. So, basically what I'm going to be doing is, if I can wake up and actually talk correctly, is play through the whole game. I'm going to go ahead and beat the game on normal mode. I shouldn't have any trouble doing that. I actually did a live stream of this on Twitch just a couple weeks ago. And I had no problems getting through it then, so I shouldn't have any problems getting through it now. And I'll sort of just talk about the game as I go along and tell you guys, my personal tactics and so forth to progress through the game. But first things first, in Thunder Force 4... or Lightning Force, you want to hold down A and press start before you begin if you want to check out your options menu and whatnot. So we're going to go ahead and do that and just hold down A and then press start just like that. So this is how you get to your options menu in this game. And if you're new to this game, I highly recommend going to the options, tweaking the difficulty and stuff like that. You can put it on Maniac if you want to, if you're feeling crazy, but I'm not. I do need to go back and actually try to play through it on this mode and see if I can do it. I think I might have actually done it back in the day, but I don't remember. So we're going to be doing it on normal mode, which is probably where I would recommend to start off. I mean, the game can get pretty tough on the harder difficulty modes, but normal is just right in my opinion. You're still going to have to memorize the levels and boss patterns and enemy placement and stuff like that. But normal is good. It's a good difficulty mode to play. You can put your ship stock up to 4, which will just do the default 3. And you got a sound test mode. So if you like the soundtrack in the game, this is where you want to go. You want to go to your options menu. Now, not all of the music is unlocked right away. For instance, like the the ending theme and stuff like that is not unlocked. So you need to beat the game first before you can access the ending theme. When you finish the game, you also unlock a bunch of different tracks that weren't actually in the game. Like, I guess, the sound guys had came up with these tracks, but they just weren't used. But they went ahead and let them in there as an unlockable bonus. Sort of like an early form of unlocking stuff. Unfortunately, it doesn't save once you turn off your cart. But lots of cool stuff here. We're going to go ahead and exit out. And it should take you straight to... Okay, or not. Okay, there we go. All right. So one of the cool things about Thunder Force 4 is that you can pick the order of the first four stages. You do that in Part 3 and Part 5 as well. Okay. So never mind. Not anything special, really. But something to note is that you can play the levels, the first four, in any order you want. Personally, I just tap start, and it'll take you in the normal order. You'll go first, second, third, and fourth. I forgot which order it does, but it always starts you off at the top one, which is Strite, apparently. So I'm going to go ahead and just tap start. I'm going to go ahead and start off at the first level that I'm used to starting off with first. And I just picked up sort of an option. I think they call it Claw or Craw. I don't remember the exact name. But I got that, and this power-up is actually really useful. As you can see, it adds extra firepower, but it also absorbs bullets and things like that, so it's very, very handy. And the game is definitely considerably more difficult when you die and you lose this power-up. This power-up right here, it's B for Blade. It's a really good power-up, but I'm going to actually skip it for this Let's Play. Normally, I grab it, but I realized the other night that it's actually harder to take down the first boss when you have the Blade power-up, which overrides your red shot up the top there. So you can see up at the top of the screen, it says Twin Shot. You have five slots. Those are your shots. And so I don't want to pick up the Blade. And tapping A actually increases your speed or decreases depending. And what I usually do is keep it around 75%. You can go 25, 50, or 75 or 100%. 100% is a little, it's useful at certain parts of the game, but for the most part, I like a more upper medium level speed, which is in the 75% range. And that's what I'm most comfortable with playing that. You might feel otherwise. I feel 25 and 50% is usually a little too slow for me. It's tough to avoid certain shots when you're only sitting at, when you're only going this fast. So I only play at 75 or 100, but 75 is that sweet spot for me. I'm going to put it up to 100 now because there's a hidden power-up down here. There's the freeway shot. So let me pause it again. That freeway shot I picked up, it's actually hidden behind one of the rocks, so to say, down there. There's also an extra life in the middle of the screen, and you always kind of want to go for that. But if you go all the way down to the bottom of the screen, you'll pick up the freeway, which is a pretty good shot. When it's facing forward, you just shoot out this sort of red shot in front of you. But if you press the D-pad into a different direction, you can actually aim where the array of spread shots are going. And it's definitely a very useful weapon because it's a spread shot for one, but it's also very, very powerful if you can get up close to an enemy and do what people call point blanking, where you get so close to an enemy that every single shot you see here will make contact. Like, you'll be this close to the enemy, but every single one of those missiles will hit, and thus you'll do a huge damage very quickly. So this weapon can be very, very useful in certain situations, and it's definitely, I think, important that you get used to using this weapon. Now, what's great about this game is every weapon is useful. You're not going to be relying on just a single weapon all the way through the game, and that's one of the great things about this game. And in other Thunder Force games, the weapons were oftentimes unbalanced. And for instance, in Thunder Force 5, you would just use the free-range weapon for most of the game. It was overpowered. But this game isn't like that. You're going to be using every single weapon in the game, which is great. And yet another one of the reasons why I really enjoy this one more than the other ones in the series. It's just a more balanced game overall. Unfortunately, it does have some slowdown. We get to experience that basically for the first time at this boss here. Now, there was a teensy tiny bit of slowdown before we got here. But for the most part, this boss just really starts to slow down. Slowdown wise, so now I'm firing, but I'm really just trying to fire at his fireballs that come out. And if I really wanted to not have slowdown, I could just stop firing. And that's a big reason why there is slowdown there, is because I was firing. So you can sort of control that slowdown a little bit if you want. But this is the part why I did not pick up the Blade power up. If you notice, his core there, right in his crotch area of all places, when you shoot that, you'll notice these little clouds that sort of come up as you make contact with him. And when the clouds are orange, like you see right there, that means I'm actually doing damage to the enemy. And when they're blue, it means I missed the weak point and I'm not doing any damage at all. And when you have the Blade power up, and you'll see later on, this weapon I have turns into these big, like almost ninja star looking blades. And they're so big that you don't usually make contact with that small little orb in his body. And it's actually easier to hit him there in his weak spot with the default stock twin shot. So that's why I stuck with the twin shot. But after this level, I'm going to go ahead and switch it back up and get the Blade power up. Ooh, how did I die from that? That was weird. That was really weird, actually. I don't think that's really... I mean, I'm sure it's happened before in the past, but it doesn't usually happen these days. Weird. Whoa, man, I took him down really fast. Yeah, if I had the blade power, I would have been fighting him for like another minute at least. So that's actually something I just decided to try out today. Normally I just go to him with the blade power up and I just, you know, I spend the extra time trying to take him down just to have that power up. But I decided to go ahead and experiment with just using the twin shot, and it worked great. So that was a really good strategy to pick. If you're trying to do something like speedrunning the game, and you're trying to just take on the bosses as absolutely fast as possible, and if that's the first level you pick, that's definitely a good strategy to use to take him down really fast. So this is the snake power-up. It only goes up and down, and you get a small shot, you know, directly in front of you, which is a weak shot. But the sort of grenades that go up and down are extremely powerful. As you can see there, I just took those things out in just a couple hits. But here's the blade power-up I was talking about. And as you can see, it's like these really cool-looking, like, blades. It's a cool power-up. And I will be using it a lot from this point on. It's a very, very useful weapon. And this is a good part to demonstrate how your claw, or your crawl, absorbs bullets. So as you can see, I didn't really have to do much there. I just absorbed most of those bullets. And that is exactly what you're going to do for a lot of the game. You're going to absorb a lot of bullets throughout the course of the game. Although, just because you can absorb bullets, it doesn't mean the game's going to get easy. You still have to know the game and stuff like that. And here's the Hunter power-up, which is basically a homing shot. It's a spread homing shot. It's, again, very useful. Again, like I said, all the weapons in this game are quite useful. You know, a lot of these weapons are better in certain situations than others, which is also great. It's exactly what you want from a balanced shooter. And you can pretty much, you know, there's enemies that come up from behind you, you can use the railgun. Enemies that come up from above and below you, use the snake. Freeway shot, just point blank guys like this if I wanted to, although I'm not doing any damage. Blade, obviously, is probably the most powerful shot directly in front of you, unless, again, you can point blank with the freeway shot. Now, this guy's slightly different than some other bosses in that he actually blinks once you start hitting his weak point, which is cool. Not every boss in this game does that. You need to watch out for sort of the orange smoke or the orange clouds that come up when you make contact with bosses. And if you're making contact with a boss and you're just seeing blue clouds coming off of them, that means you're not doing any damage and you need to try to attack them somewhere else. So in this level, there's actually a few different ways or a few different points on these ships that you can attack. For one, if you look directly above, next to the stream of bullets, is this little turret. It sort of shoots out three-way shots. You could destroy those. And then on the tops of the ships, there are these like small red orbs, and you could destroy those as well. So what you're going to see me doing is trying to go for those things specifically. And you could use the Hunter shot to make your life a lot easier, because what's great about the Hunter is that it goes through certain objects. It goes through a lot of walls and things like that. Ooh, that was close. Almost got hit by that. And this part's a little interesting, too. You've got these guys that sort of track onto you, and you just want to keep moving. Otherwise, they just fire directly at you. Not a very difficult part, but it's still pretty cool. It uses a very basic form of scaling as well. If you notice, the objects, the ships at the top are huge. And then the bullets they shoot, they actually sort of scale in a little bit, which is pretty neat. It's not an effect you saw a lot used in Genesis games. I mean, it was there, it was used, you know, in certain applications, but in just straight 2D games like this, there wasn't a whole lot that tried to simulate a pseudo 3D effect as you were just scrolling along, blasting stuff, which is pretty cool. Thunder Force 4 has a lot of great graphical effects, actually. It's got some awesome background scrolling, as you could see. There's just always a lot going on in the backgrounds. And the Genesis was just really good at doing that. And you saw that in a lot of games. For instance, like Sonic the Hedgehog did that. But Thunder Force 4 does it very well. And it's definitely one of its strong points in terms of the graphics department. And does some other cool stuff throughout the course of the game as well, graphically speaking. So the Hunter shot is making quick work of these ships. And most of the enemies that come up, actually. Now you see there's a big stream of rockets coming up from below me. You want to sort of just stay above and hide above one of the ships, and the rockets will just sort of run into them. There's a claw if you missed it. Or if you don't have one, not if you missed it, but if you died and you lost your power up or something like that. Alright, so now we're going to go to a speed up mode, and I think it's probably good to put yourself up onto 100 right now. And there will be an extra life here, I believe. There it is, right there. Alright, now this boss is pretty interesting. There's three things you have to do in a very specific order. The first is, I believe, to destroy his front, just like that. Then get behind him, use the railgun to blow this part off. And then use the snake to destroy this top sort of weak spot up here. Just like that. And if you don't do it in that specific order, you're going to be sitting there all day attacking him, wondering, why isn't this boss dying? You have to do it in that very specific order. Some bosses in this game have methodologies like that you really have to go by in order to take bosses down. Others, it's more just about spamming firepower at them for a certain period of time and just doing enough damage. Alright, we've got our little mini-boss here. And on to basically the second half of the stage. And if you're not very good at this game, what I would recommend doing is if you get the Hunter power up, wow, another extra life. I'm up to 8 lives right now. We're in very good shape in terms of lives. But if you're not that great at the game and you get the Hunter power up, you might want to just use that. Because you don't have to aim, really. You can just sit back and, you know, let the spread shots do, the homing spread shots do all the work for you. Now granted, you still have to be a little careful. It's not going to take everything down. Again, it's not a broken power-up. It's not going to do everything for you. It might even home in onto enemies you don't want it to home in onto. Sometimes it sort of prioritizes the things you don't want. The things you don't want to attack. For the most part, it makes quick work of a lot of enemies in the game. And you can just try to sit, say, at the top of the screen and just use the Hunter power-up. So switch back over to Blade, and we're going to go ahead and fight our next boss. Now this guy, if I recall correctly, you want to sort of take out, or you want to hit him in the front, but when his shield goes away, you sort of want to hit him down below and blow his bottom portion off. So kind of get up close like this. Just like that. We're gonna switch to the freeway. Look at that. That jet definitely made very quick work out of that. So I have to hit him directly in the face now. There we go, got him. Hitting him below, after you blow his bottom half off, it doesn't do any damage. So you have to actually hit him in the face. Now this is basically the halfway point in the game. This is stage 5, and at this point, once you get past this level, you'll get a special power-up that allows you to charge. It's basically an upgrade for your ship. It changes the look of your ship, but it also allows you to charge up and do this massive shot, which does a huge amount of damage, and you'll see what I mean later on in the game. I'll start taking down certain large enemies just in one shot, basically, with this charge power-up. It's really cool. Now again, it's not broken either. It's like you can't just use the charge power-up because there's going to be so many enemies coming at you, and it takes a little while for it to charge up. So it's like you can't, you have to not fire in order to charge it up. So it's one of those weapons where it's risky to try to get it going. And there's going to be a lot of turrets and so forth and lasers coming up from the bottom here. These sort of red doors open up, and you want to destroy those. Missiles and so forth come out of there. I'm going to go ahead and use the Hunter power-up. Nope, not working. It's trying to home in on the missiles, so... It's gonna be an extra life right down here, as you can see. 9 lives. We are in great shape in terms of our lives. So this guy right here, you might even be able to just get through him without even shooting. But I haven't tried that before. I'm gonna go ahead and just fire anyway. He's not really much of a boss at all. He's just sort of, almost an interactive cinematic sequence, if you ask me. Basically what it serves is to show that he exists, because you actually fight him again just before the final boss on the very final stage. And then you get this power-up right here, right now. I really like how the sky, or the, you know, the stars and whatnot, the whole background turns orange, which is really cool. Again, like I said, the game has some really cool graphical effects. It's just everything it does, I think, is very tasteful. And again, like I said, it's definitely the most mature Thunder Force game, graphically speaking. So... I think if I take a top path, there's going to be another extra life, and I think there's also a shield power up somewhere up here. So in case I get hit, I already have the shield, but in case I get hit and it wears thin, I can basically get it re-upped. The shield is definitely a must-have power up in this game. It just makes life so much easier, which is the case for any shoot 'em up with shields in them, like Darius, the Darius series. Man, those games are so difficult if you run out of your shields. So a lot of those games, it's about managing your shields. This game's not really about managing your shields, so to say, as it is just getting them. So here's the shield right here. And I just let my power-up charge up by accident. I wasn't really intending on doing that, but that was the blast right there. It's a huge shot. You're going to see me using that on the boss. It just really makes quick work of the boss, which is great. It's another snake power-up. It looks like you get 10,000 points if you pick up a power-up that you already have. So if you're trying to play for score, that's really good to know. And I like it when shoot-em-ups do that. Not all shoot-em-ups will give you points for picking up firepower, even if you're already maxed out. That's a very, very little tight thing right there, getting that extra life. 10 lives. I don't know if I've ever had 10 lives before. That's pretty solid. Although I am using a ROM, so there's the possibility that whoever released the ROM hacked it or something like that and gave me more lives or reduced the score threshold for extra lives, if that's even possible. I don't think that's the case, though. So I am playing this on my flash card, so. But either way, I'm not going to use 10 lives to beat the game, so it's not going to be really a problem. Let's go ahead and just let that charge up. We're going to go ahead and use it on the boss. Now what's interesting about this weapon is that if you hold forward, the attack sort of like goes in, and if you hold back, it sort of spreads out. And I'll show you what I mean right now. So I'm going to hold back and use it. It sort of like goes out in more of a spread fashion. Whereas I'm going to go ahead and use hold forward when I use it this time, and it sort of crosses over like an X. Alright, so that was stage 6, we're on stage 7 now, and this level's probably good, it's probably good to use Hunter on this level, for part of it anyway. I think there's a part where your Hunter gets distracted, your Hunter power gets distracted by other enemies, and so you have to switch off to something else. And there's another freeway one, picking up those points. And these little guys right here, they're sort of like swinging around me. These are actually really interesting because you can't shoot them. Your shots don't do anything. You have to actually slam them into the walls in order to get them to go away. It's kind of an interesting little gimmick that you don't see in too many shooters. So just sort of hug the wall and they all just died. I'm going to switch off to the snake. Actually, I'm going to go ahead and just use Blade. Blade works well enough. Normally that guy doesn't last that long, but normally I also don't use the Hunter on him. Normally I just use Blade. His weak spot is just directly in front of him, so Blade is really the one to use when enemies are just really right in front of you. So there's a lot of these little bubbles and whatnot on this stage. You need to watch out for these. You need to shoot them down, because if you touch them, you will take damage. You will lose your shield, and then you will die once you lose your shield. And this is the boss. He basically starts off here on the ground, and then he basically comes up off the ground and becomes very, very aggressive. So go ahead and use the charge power up here. Because again, it's very powerful. Just like that, he's big. I wouldn't recommend using your charge power up on him. Just keep firing away. Because a lot of the shots that he shoots out can be shot down with your own bullets. He even does an attack where he slams down on the ground. And I recommend just staying back, to be honest. Bam, just like that. So just stay back like this. Use your claw to absorb those bullets. You don't have to just dodge everything. You can just play a little more strategically. At least on normal mode. On Maniac, it might be a different story. So here's stage 8. Probably my favorite track in the game, musically speaking. It's a little edgy. What's up, little girl? My cat's over there just meowing at me. So this level's actually pretty tough. There's a bunch of like sort of little mini-boss sections. There's even a part in the level where you can only get some power-ups if you purposely smash through a wall. So you have to use your shield basically in order to grab some of the power-ups. Now this guy right here you can actually take down in one shot with your charge shot. So we're gonna go ahead and do that. Go ahead and open up. Bam, you're gone. Just like that. Hunter is a great weapon to use here, so use it. So a lot of these little spider crawly things, it'll just home straight in on them. And you need to take down these things. These are sort of like trash disposal units or something like that. I have no idea. Got another extra life, but it looks like 10 lives is the maximum. Basically killed him in one shot, too. I don't think I've ever tried that before. He's a little tricky if you try to charge up, because he does that spinning shot, and it just... Yeah. It's a little risky to not be firing at him. Switch back down to 75%. Gonna try to get this guy to face the other way so I can charge up and see if I can take him down in one hit too, just like the other ones. It worked. It's a close shot. I almost got hit by his laser. So if you notice a gray part of his arms here, those are actually the weak points. And these guys are kind of a pain, these little bug things. When you destroy them, they fall to the ground and make these explosions that push you up into the ceiling. So you really have to watch out for them. Very, very tricky. Alright, so you want to just sit back. He's going to pretty much explode like the whole left-hand side of the screen. So depending on where he lands, you need to get behind him. Otherwise, you're probably going to die. Again, it's not really that difficult. It's just about knowing what's coming up. And so when you're unfamiliar with the game, you are going to pretty much die because you just don't know what's going to happen. And we've got these things here that are going to pretty much collapse the ceiling in on me. And I've got this thing that's stuck to me. I don't think I've ever gotten it stuck before. There we go. and it was actually weighing me down, which was interesting. I don't think I've ever touched one of those things before. These guys right here, you need to keep shooting them, and then they recoil back. There's another shield, just in time, because I had just lost the other one. So just keep firing at them, and then quickly get through, because they will recoil back very, very quickly. Just shortly is where the ceiling is going to come down on me, but there will be an extra life up top. You guys will see what I mean once we get to that part. But yeah, this is the second to last stage, guys. We're already close to the end of the game. We're almost going to beat this game. This is where the ceiling comes down. Extra life up top. Ooh, it does go past 10. Okay, I'm at 11 right now. Interesting. I'm going to take the top route. These things sort of spread out. You need to shoot the solid ones. Just like that. Back to the bottom route. It's gonna be another power up down here. In case you died. For us, it's just points. I'll take points. It's always a good feeling when you play well at these games and you just rack up an insane score. More points. There's gonna be another extra life up here, actually. Now that I think about it, I don't think it's another extra life. And these guys, if you start shooting, they actually home in on you. So sometimes it's easier to just try to dodge them outright, which is kind of interesting. And just use your hunter here. Actually, it's not an extra life here. It's actually a shortcut. And I'll show you what I mean once we get to it. It's kind of like on the ice level we got to. Oh, look, there's an extra life. Oh, yeah. No. Go straight through, just like that. And then you can also go straight through right here. Instead of actually going up and all the way around. See, look at that. Straight through, just like that. Just like on the ice stage where the rocks are really close to you, or close to crushing you. It looks like you can't actually go through, but I think it was intentionally designed like that. Now this boss can actually be a little tricky. I'm gonna go at speed up to 100%. Oh yeah, we have to go behind him and shoot the these turrets first. So you want to just use the railgun for that. Or you can get up close and use your freeway shot. I'd probably just use the railgun, it's a little bit easier. He's gonna go ahead and do a fire shot. Is that it? I think that's it. That is it. We got lucky there, actually. Normally he does this dual fire shot. It's very tough to avoid. And he didn't do it once. Although when I was streaming live, that's pretty much all he did. And it was kind of annoying, and I died a lot. So here's our friends from earlier. And he does this homing attack. And he'll sort of back up a little bit before he does it. Oh, he does it from above. I thought it, I thought it was going to come out more from the center. Yeah, this is where you start losing lives, when you lose your power-ups and whatnot. So when he ducks down like that, you need to, get to one side of the screen or the other. And his weak point is up here. You need to shoot up top. Just like so. But once you do this, you're pretty much at the final boss. And then it's the end of the game. You know, we're not going to have a problem with the final boss himself, and that dude that we just fought can be a little tricky. And he's going to come back out. He's just sort of in hiding, if you will. And that's it. Extra life. Okay, I'll take it. I want to see you get bonus points for beating the game without dying, but that was not us. We died a couple times, unfortunately, right at the very end. Here's the final boss. It's got another sort of dark, edgy, metal-like tune. I've always liked this. Good way to end the game. You basically have to shoot his left and right sides. So we'll go ahead and not go over to the right now. We're gonna have to wait. He's going to slam just like that. You really gotta watch out for that. That'll actually kill you really fast. Now his little orb, his sort of eyeball is gonna come out. He's gonna have these things spinning around his sides that you can sort of take out. They'll shoot bullets at you and whatnot. But the trick is taking out his eye once it shoots out. Just like that. So it always comes down to the right and then bounces up, goes to the left. And usually what happens with me is I just shoot it and stay at the right, and I'll do a pattern or two of that before I take him out. But if you go straight for it, so shoot it as it's coming down to the right, and as it bounces back up, veer over to the left side of the screen and then go straight for it once it comes back down. And again, as you saw with the freeway shot, you can just take it out in, you know, in one pattern. In one loop of the pattern, as you could call it. So yeah, that's Thunder Force 4, guys, also known as Lightning Force in the United States. Not sure why they decided to change the name when I think about it. Because there had been two Thunder Force games in America. There was also a first one. I don't know if the first one was released outside of Japan. It was like, I think it was like a computer game, old computer game. But yeah, there was Thunder Force 2 and 3 on the Sega Genesis, so I'm not sure why they changed the name. But, yeah. We're gonna basically go through this little story segment here, and then the credits are gonna roll up. And then it's going to tally up my final score. What's up, little girl? Come here. Come on up here. Come on. I'll do a kitty cam. You wanna get on camera? Come on up. Come on. Come on. Good girl. It's kitty cam time. Let's do this. You ready? Hey, little girl. What you doing? What you doing? My cat is an attention whore. That's right. Yes, you are. Goofy cat. Oh, man. She's definitely made doing these Let's Plays interesting. It's one more thing I have to worry about as I'm playing these games. There she goes. Ah, critter. I tell you. She's doing laps around my apartment. It's crazy. Oh, man. So believe it or not, I think the ending's actually bad. You save like all mankind or something like that. And normally I don't care about story and shmups, but because Thunder Force is, every game is a sequel to the last one. And in Thunder Force 5, spoiler alert, just stop if you don't want to know this, if you've never played it. But I guess this ship that we played as in the game basically gets abducted or, gets taken over by a different entity, and you have to fight it in Thunder Force 5. It's actually the halfway point. There you go. Basically, your ship's just kind of destroyed right now. So you actually have to fight it at the halfway point in Thunder Force 5, kind of like there was a halfway point stage in this game. You got a power up. You get a power up in Thunder Force 5 halfway through, kind of like you do in Thunder Force 4. So. And there's probably a big bonus for doing it without dying. I actually kind of wanted to see what that bonus was. But yes, so you have to fight the original ship from Thunder Force 4 in Part 5, and it plays the intro music from this game as that boss music, which is very cool. So, rank ace. Look at that. I'm an ace, apparently, guys, according to my Sega Genesis here. Thanks, Genesis and Thunder Force 4. Although, pretty much every shoot 'em up from this time period did not have a backup battery, and so you basically lose your scores once you turn it off, which was a shame. It makes me wonder how much extra money would have cost to implement a battery in these games, because it's just not the same playing them for score without having a battery to do the backup for you. Yeah, I could write the scores down. That's just not as much fun. It's nice booting up a cart and having all the scores there. So this theme right here is what plays as the boss theme when you fight this ship in Thunder Force 5. It's pretty cool. A bit of a nostalgia trip there. Alright guys, so I'm going to go ahead and wrap things up here. As usual, thanks for watching. Hope you guys enjoyed this video. I'll be back with some more Let's Plays and streams now sometime soon. And until then, take it easy, guys.